the founder of Election Watchdog, National Citizens Movement for Free Election, or NAMFREL, Jose Concepcion Jr., has passed away. He was 92 years old. The former trade secretary founded NAMFREL in 1983. He was also president and COO of Republic Four Mills until 1986. Public viewing for his wake will be from March 7 to 10th at the Heritage Memorial Park in Taguig City. From all of us here in the newsroom, our deepest condolences. The Philippine information and technology sector revamps its image in a bid to attract more foreign investors. Jackie Pascual reports.
The Philippines Information Technology Business Process Management, or ITBPM, sector is getting a facelift as it looks to rebrand. Spearheaded by the IT and Business Process Association of the Philippines, the We Are with the Philippines campaign aims to reshape perceptions on the industry and to eventually attract more investments. This as IBPAP aims to reach over 1.8 million employees this 2024 from 1.7 million last year and plans to contribute $40 billion to the Philippine economy, up from last year's $35.5 billion.
Because there's still a fundamental misunderstanding of our industry as a career. People think call center lang yan. We really need to just change this image.
In India, it is not shameful to work for a BPO amongst Indian families. In the Philippines, I think it's less now, but before, people would still have that stigma. But magbi-BPO ka rather than be a proper doctor or nurse or engineer.
IBPAP says the IT-BPM sector covers several fields, including healthcare, finance, animation, and more. One aspect they want to improve is how schools also perceive the sector, because not many are incorporating learnings to equip students with the right skill set to enter the IT-BPM sector.
The need to regularly upgrade and strengthen one's skill set. Because technology is changing so fast, the job expectations of our investors are also changing. They're becoming more complex. They're looking for a combination of domain and technical skills.
We are still quite traditional with our curricula, and the IT and the non-IT wall, super separated. So what happens is, you're an accountant, graduate, you'll take extra courses pa. Or the company will train you pa, extra cost.
There are also issues with local governments, which sometimes can be a turnoff to investors.
We have some challenges on at the city LGU level with respect to renewal of, I'll give you some examples, renewal of local business permits, for example. Being connected to the health certificates of employees, and these are, you know, these are quite disturbing and irritating to investors. What is damaging is when these rules, which are well written mostly, are interpreted in a different way by different cities.
IBPAP now asks its members to help in the campaign, especially as the Philippines faces competition from other countries in the sector and also with the rise of artificial intelligence.
It's not just India anymore. There are other countries that are looking at getting a piece of our market share. Countries like South Africa, Colombia in South America, Vietnam, Poland, and even Egypt. They want to be where we are. So let us not just defend our share, let us strengthen our market share.
IBPAP has ambitious goals of becoming a $59 billion industry and employing 2.5 million by 2028. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Well, a Philippine House lawmaker weighs in on the proposal to open up the education sector to foreigners. Roman Romulo, the chairman of the House Committee on Basic Education and Culture, says liberalizing the sector should not be done to attract foreign investments, but instead to promote quality education in the Philippines. Romulo adds, foreign control of basic and higher education must be discussed separately. Both chambers of Congress are proposing to amend the 1987 Constitution to allow foreign entities to have full control and ownership of schools in the country.
I agree that we should treat basic education and higher education separately. When the 87 Constitution was framed, that was the environment was different then. That time we did not have technology that we have today. So when you talk about effectively making schools instill values, at that time, really it was the parents, the teachers that primarily taught many of our, or influenced many of our learners. But now you have Wi-Fi, you have social media. Our higher education institution learners or students more or less are about 17, 18 years old. So at that point in time, you have a more mature foundational skills have already been, competencies have already been instilled or supposed to have been instilled, then that is why we should treat them differently.